will never be worth a lot. The reasoning is that they've been overproduced and that everybody knows to keep them in mint condition. So in the future, all the cards from the past couple of years will all be in great shape, and thus they're not great long-term investments. To some degree, they are right, but a recent decision by the National Hockey League and its Players Association could change all that. It has been decided that no player who is a non-NHLPA member can appear in a card set with players who are members of the NHLPA. For the last 2 years, since the introduction of Score and Upper Deck into the card market, the big cards in the sets have been of non-NHLPA members, players who haven't yet appeared in the NHL, whether they be Europeans, draft picks, or minor leaguers who are not yet members. The way a player becomes a member of the NHLPA is by playing in one regular season NHL game. Then he's automatically a member. Well, the Players Association has decided that it's not fair that some companies have some players and that others have others. They've all paid the same amount for their license, and they should all start on equal footing. There will be a grandfather clause, however, in the case of Eric Lindros. He will be allowed to appear in the Score Pinnacle set due out in late March. Pinnacle is the latest of the premier high-quality sets, and it's about time the Score got into the market because the other companies are really taking away from Score's thunder. Score has been known as being the best card company when it comes to player selection, and Lindros is a large reason for that. Originally, they were told he would not be included in the Pinnacle set, but the NHL and the Players Association has decided that this is the last time. So next year, everybody in the sets must be NHLPA members. There'll be no Soviet subsets, and there'll be no draft picks. So the 1990-91 and the 91-92 card series will be unique. They'll be the only ones that really include 2 years of rookies in one set. Until next time, I'm Rand Simon for Collectibles Corner.
The guessing game will begin for collectors when Opeachy Premier Hockey comes out for its second season. Will it be like last year's Premier Hockey, which started as low as $20 a box and made its way up to $300? Or will it be more like this year's baseball, which started out high, reached as high as $120 a box, and then went down as low to the current level of about $50 a box? One of the key factors, of course, is who was in the set. The rookie selection this year is quite good. It's a 198-card set featuring Pat Falloon, Scott Niedermeyer, Tony Amonte, and Nicholas Lidstrom. But last year's Premier had the really great rookies. After all, it's tough to beat Sergei Fedorov, Jaromir Jagr, Kevin Stevens, or Jeremy Roenick. The other factor to consider, of course, is production numbers. One dealer that I spoke with said that there was actually going to be less Premier this year than last year. Logically, that doesn't make a lot of sense. You would think, considering the success of the product, that Opeachy would actually make more. But this year, dealers were limited to an order of 5 cases. Last year, they got as many as 50 cases. But that does not necessarily mean that there will be less Premier. All that means is that it'll be distributed. In the high-priced world of hockey card collecting, it's quite ironic that one of the most popular things going these days is a 29-cent pack of cards available only at your local McDonald's. Upper Deck has produced an all-star card series. There's 25 cards plus 6 holograms, but you can only get them at McDonald's, and you can only get them in Canada. And that's one reason why they've become extremely popular. Dealers in the States would love to get their hands on these cards, but it's very difficult for them. They've got to come up here or buy them from someone here who has them. And because the production run is obviously much smaller than regular Upper Deck cards, the cards are relatively scarce. You get 3 cards and 1 hologram per pack anytime you go to McDonald's and buy a soft drink. Depending on the person behind the counter, you can get anywhere from between 1 to 10 packs of cards. They're a really good investment, and this might be the kind of thing where you want to keep the cards sealed for the future, because I really believe that these are going to go up in value. Speaking of Upper Deck, I recently received this press release from the company. It concerns the Eric Lindros card. When the company made the Lindros card, there were rumors that Score would interfere and prevent Upper Deck from distributing all of the cards. Richard McWilliam, the president of Upper Deck, assures collectors in this press release that that is not the case. There is some misbelief that the card production has stopped, so it's become a hot collectible, McWilliam says. The fact that Lindros is a popular athlete and the rumor that the card is not widely available makes it even more desirable. We want to assure card collectors that we have not interrupted our shipping or changed the established production level for any card in our 1991-92 hockey series. What that means is don't believe the rumors that the Lindros card is any rarer than any other in the series. There are just as many Lindros cards as there are of anyone else in this year's Upper Deck Hockey. Until next time, I'm Rand Simon for Collectibles Corner.